Hey, let's have some fun with this one. What are the 5 foods that you should never, ever, ever break your fast with? Well, let's investigate this. I'm gonna save you some time and effort though. Realistically, you should only be breaking your fast with lean protein. That's like what you should be doing. So I can save you a few minutes watching this video, but realistically, I think you're gonna get some fun value out of this video, so watch it anyway, now that you at least know what to break your fast with. Anyhow, please do make sure you hit that red subscribe button, and then please hit the bell icon that's down there and select all notifications. This is the internet's leading intermittent fasting and prolonged fasting channel. All kinds of new content coming out daily, so please, hit that notification button, be part of my notification squad, and let's have some fun learning together. First thing you need to focus on is not having foods with a high glycemic load, okay? Glycemic index is one thing, but glycemic load is even more important. Now, hear me out on this, and I'm gonna wrap this all together, okay? During a fast, what ends up happening is your body has a unique ability to maintain electrolyte homeostasis within the cell pretty well. You see, what happens is during a fast, you're not consuming any electrolytes, right? So what ends up happening is the cells within your body say, well, hey, we're not getting any salt or anything coming in here, so it starts to draw it from the bloodstream. So what happens is your serum levels of electrolytes go down. And that confuses people and they think they need to load up on a ton of salt and stuff like that. A little bit's fine. But anyway, I digress. Point is the cells take up some of those electrolytes and that leaves you with low levels of electrolytes in the blood, but high levels within the cell. Well, then when you eat after you break your fast, you spike your insulin and the insulin opens up the cell doorway. And guess what happens? By the laws of osmolarity, water and nutrients and everything's gonna flow to wherever there is more or less of something, right? So what ends up happening is you have this massive infusion of all of your electrolytes that you just consumed coming into the cell. Okay, so basically, if you were to take 2 water balloons, one water balloon had water with salt in it and one water balloon just had water, and you magically connected them, all the water from the one water balloon, by laws of osmolarity, are gonna flow into the one balloon that already has salt water in it. This is happening inside your cell. And this is called, quote, refeeding syndrome in the scientific community. Now, it generally only happens at fasts that are like over 24 hours, but it still happens to a smaller degree even with intermittent fasting. So I will tell you a way to combat this first. The first thing is have a little bit of sodium in your blood before you break your fast. What this is gonna do is it's going to make that radical extreme a little bit less extreme because you have a little bit more balance of osmolarity. So having a little bit of salt prior to breaking your fast can help you out with that. The reason we wanna avoid a massive load of insulin is because it's gonna open the door bigger. A little bit of insulin is fine. In fact, I talk about in a lot of situations, if you're trying to manipulate insulin sensitivity after a workout or anything like that, sure, have 1 or 2 rice cakes, but we're talking 10 or 15 grams of carbs here. What I want you to avoid is anything in excess of 25 grams of carbohydrates, especially if they're high glycemic. The refeeding syndrome can make you feel lethargic, and quite honestly, it can damage the membrane of the cell because the rapid translocation of those ions can mess stuff up. So that's actually number one, very, very important there. Lean protein really is just the best. Food to avoid number two, actually 2 foods, almonds and cashews. First of all, mechanically, they're very difficult on the body. Okay, your gut mucosal layer is broken down after a fast. You don't want rough, tough almonds breaking up your gut. It's not good. Plus, almonds and cashews are high in phytic acid and oxalates, which both chelate minerals. Now, at the end of a fast, you are usually fairly deficient in magnesium. Magnesium is so important after you break your fast for proper ATP regeneration, for proper mitochondrial biogenesis, for recovering from your fast, right? So what happens is, if you consume almonds and cashews, they're going to chelate any of the magnesium that you do have left or you're getting in from the diet and make it so you're not absorbing it. This poses a very big problem. So really, you should just be avoiding that altogether. But again, it comes right back to just having lean protein. Keep it simple. This next one is intriguing, and I know some of you might poke holes in it because I'm a big fan of shellfish. I absolutely love shellfish in the diet. It is phenomenal. It is the future of protein in many cases. You know, we're talking clams, we're talking shrimp, anything like that, right? But don't break your fast with it. Usually I would recommend breaking your fast with like lean fish or lean chicken. and then having the shellfish later on, like with the next meal. The reason is because during a fast, you become deficient in something known as thiamine. Thiamine is also known as vitamin B1, but it's involved in glucose metabolism. And for whatever reason, during a fast, through long series of events, you become somewhat deficient in it. Well, when you break your fast and you have some carbohydrates, which you really shouldn't anyway, but if you do have some carbohydrates and you break your fast, it dramatically depletes your thiamine levels because it's involved in that glucose metabolism. Okay, so you ingest carbs, thiamine levels deplete even more. Okay, but shellfish contains something interesting known as thiaminase. And just like the name implies, it works with thiamine, but it disrupts thiamine and it changes the structure. It's an enzyme that works with it. So it makes it so that you actually don't utilize thiamine properly. You're not utilizing vitamin B1. So if you're thiamine deficient at the end of a fast, shellfish makes you more deficient, or makes it so that any thiamine you are getting in, which is funny because thiamine is in the shellfish itself, but it has this thiaminase that renders it somewhat useless. So just keep it lean chicken, whatever, lean beef, whatever you want to do, and keep the shellfish in later on. I want to make sure I stress that you know that thiamine deficiency is not like a huge, huge problem in our world. It's not something you're gonna have to worry about beyond breaking your fast, okay? It's just important right after breaking your fast. After that, don't worry about it. It's pretty uncommon. I do wanna make a mention though, there is a link down below for Thrive Market, which is an online membership-based grocery store. I do have a bunch of foods and grocery items through my Thrive Market boxes that are things that I would recommend you consume during the eating period of your fast. So I have things like seaweed snacks. I have all the foods that kind of help replenish the vitamins that you might deplete. Anyway, they're an online membership-based grocery store. So they deliver like your groceries right to your doorstep. And you can shop by category. You can select keto. You can select this, that, and shop all the foods that they have within a given category. It's like going to a grocery store, but being able to walk down an aisle that says keto or walk down an aisle that says paleo. It is really darn cool. So go ahead and click the link down below and you can check them out. Big thank you to Thrive for supporting this channel as well. Check them out after this video. The next one is one that's gonna be hard for people that are low carb dieters too, and that's to avoid the saturated fats after your fast. You really should keep the fats out of the equation anyway, but saturated fats especially. See, it has to do with the fact that when you're fasting, it makes economic sense metabolically to stop producing a bunch of digestive enzymes. If you're not eating, why does your body need to go through the metabolic effort to create them and waste energy, right? Well, it turns out the saturated fats, because of the way the hydrogen bonds are, they're very difficult to mechanically digest and break down. So they end up sitting there and causing a problem. Well, that's pretty simple. So you basically want to make sure that whenever you're breaking your fast, any fats that you do get in are coming in from things like olive oil, which are relatively easy to break down. I also don't recommend MCT oil simply because it's a little hard on the gut. So olive oil, avocado oil are good to go. Saturated fats are going to be best saved for the meal following. It's the same reason why if you were to feel some lard versus feel some olive oil is going to feel lighter, it's going to feel airy, it's going to feel fresher. Whereas lard's gonna feel greasy and heavy, even though they're the same caloric density, the same ultimately effect on the body as far as calories are concerned. Okay, it has to do with how the body breaks it down and being able to cleave off those individual carbon chains that are bound with hydrogen. Okay, so very, very important there. That can cause you a lot of gastric distress. And a big one, okay, a lot of people think that they should break their fast with veggies, and it makes mental sense. Okay, like you want to do this because it's important that, yeah, after you break your fast, you're gonna get a big infusion of whatever healthy foods you take in. Whatever you eat at that point in time, your body is going to soak up like a sponge. So I agree. Like it makes sense to want to eat your greens and get your veggies right when you break a fast. The problem is that there's a mechanical digestive piece that stands in the way, especially with insoluble fiber. Okay, we're talking kale, we're talking celery, carrots. You're getting the gist here. Brussels sprouts, things that are insoluble fiber, lots of roughage. Straight up lettuce. A salad at the end of a fast is one of the worst things you could have. Like a salad's gonna have dressing with fat on it, is gonna have the insoluble fiber, and then it's a mess. You don't wanna have that. Okay, now the insoluble fiber is hard on the gut that is already broken down. Okay, so the villi, the little brush-like finger things that stick in your intestines that create more surface area so you can absorb nutrients, well, they're sensitive and they atrophy at the end of a fast. And then all of a sudden you're shoving a wire brush through them with insoluble fiber. That's gonna break them even more. So you're kicking a dog while it's already down in that case, okay? You need to let your villi restore. You need to rebuild it a little bit. It doesn't take long, but insoluble fiber from veggies is not going to help you. Plus, when you digest insoluble fiber, it increases what is called peristalsis, okay? That is the movement and the contraction, okay? This means that it's going to move the food through your system faster, meaning you're absorbing less. At the end of a fast is the one time where you want digestion and absorption to actually be a little bit slow. Okay, you don't want things moving through so fast because then you're not absorbing nutrients. It's easy to get mineral deficient, nutrient deficient, vitamin deficient if you're a chronic faster. And I say chronic loosely, but it's not necessarily bad. The point is you want your digestion to be nice and gentle and slow, which again, protein takes longer to break down. You need a lot more of that enzymatic activity to allow it to happen. So then at least you're giving your body a chance to actually assimilate things. If you want more of these videos just because you find them interesting on what to eat after a fast or what not to eat after a fast, go ahead and leave a comment down below.